that's what I'm talking about, church. What are you talking about? Yeah. You're talking about how awesome our choir is, right? Right. I encourage you, if you have not decided to come tonight, decide to come, because it is wonderful. Before I came here,
you know, I lived in Los Angeles, and Troy Perry would say,
and he called us all girls. And I would have to tell him, Troy, I am not a girl. Right? But Troy said, when you go to the South, I want you to twirl your robe like a skirt and spread your glitter and get close to those people, but be appropriate. And you have all made it so easy for me to do that. So thank you so much. Thank you, choir. You're amazing. Yes. More amazing by an amazing congregation. I was thinking this morning that when I moved here, they said, oh my goodness, we really want to see this church grow. And this church has grown. Do you realize that we have almost doubled our worship attendance in just a few months? Do you realize that your offerings have been more than generous and the staff gets paid? That's a good thing. And our bills are paid. And all of that made possible because we have this amazing God that walks with us each and every day of our lives. Even in those days that we have questions and we have doubts. I believe that in this season of Advent, we're on hyper emotions, right? Things are more intense. The church is more beautiful. We've changed the whole complexion of the chancel and the altar has changed. But we are changed because we're busy. We're busy thinking about Christmas Day. We're busy buying presents for those we love. We're busy going to parties. We're busy with aspirin from our hangovers from those parties, right? And it's all good. It's all good. Because as we do those things, we create this amazing community together. And we are all part of that. And if we get real with ourselves, sometimes when life becomes life, we ask ourselves, really, what did I do to deserve this? What is happening? Where is God in this situation? How do we handle that disappointment or that news? Because even in the midst of our Christmas preparation and our Advent journey, life is life, right? And yet at the same time, we need to remember that as life is life, God is bigger than life. Because God is the creator of life. And what I love the most is that just not my God, but your God, God as you understand God, will make God's self real to you in your everyday situations. And friends, there are just times that we go through things that we do not understand. Our gospel reading this morning, John the Baptizer spent his entire life preparing and telling people about the coming Messiah. John had done nothing wrong. John lived a very meager life, wore simple clothes of camel's hair, lived in the wilderness, only ate bees and honey. Ooh! I'm not going for that diet, right? But at the same time, John's desire was to proclaim the kingdom of God coming in the here and the now. And John baptized Jesus. John saw the Holy Spirit come upon Jesus, something John had never, ever seen or experienced before. It's easy to think that John had an expectation of this Messiah. Wouldn't we? Wouldn't we, church? Of course we would. We have expectations all the time. We expect that things are going to happen often the way we want them to. And sometimes when they don't, you know how that is. Right? We don't like it. We have questions and we have doubts. So John the Baptizer finds himself in prison. Chained up. It's not pretty. No air conditioning in bed. Right?
dirt floor.
So can you imagine as John paced back and forth wondering what happened? I told them that the Messiah was coming. I've given up my life to proclaim the goodness of the kingdom of God. Why am I here in prison? God, why can't you change this situation? And what does John do? He does the smart thing. He gets one of his followers and he says, you got to go ask this Messiah guy. You got to go ask this Jesus person. Is he the one that we've been waiting for? And Jesus, as Jesus always does not answer the question with a yes or no answer, just like your pastor. Jesus needs to understand. So I'm sure Jesus was like, well, why do you think he's asking? What's up with John? Right? Tell me about that. So what is Jesus' response to John's disciple? He says, go tell John that the lame are walking, that the blind are seeing, that the people who are deaf can hear, and that the poor, the outcasts in society, their life is changing. Go and tell John those things. Now I have a question for you. If I was chained up in prison, that would not be the kind of answer that I would want to hear. What about you? Yeah. What about you? And then at the same time, I have to ask myself, what was John's response? We don't know what it was. We don't know what it was. Because the scripture, there's nowhere in the journals where that answer is. But I think the holiness is this. That Jesus was not afraid of the question. Jesus did not say, what are you talking about? Ask me that foolish question. Instead, what Jesus does is welcome the question and affirms the question. Jesus says, tell John what is happening so John will know. In Jewish tradition, we know from the Old Testament that Jesus was able to tell John's disciple those specific things because they were already recorded in the book of Isaiah. So that's kind of like John's code. Oh, this is the Messiah. What I think is wonderful is that even though John didn't do anything wrong to be in prison, and it's going to get worse for John, right? Do you remember what happens? Herod is going to have him beheaded and the head taken and given as a gift. Imagine that. Jesus doesn't stop that. He does not stop that from happening. Nor does he stop being born in a manger and dying on a cross. He doesn't stop it from happening. But he says, stay awake. What are you seeing? What are you hearing? That's different. That's different. It's the reminder of our need for the Messiah. John's question comes from his desire to have a relationship with the loving God, to have the relationship with the Messiah that had been foretold, that he believed was really happening. And it's the same message for us today. It's the same message. How many of us fear being able to ask a simple question or to share our disappointments? Or to be able to say, this is not fair. Because there are many things that happen that are not fair. They just aren't. And there are many things that happen in our lives that we don't like. There are many things that we cannot change. And yet at the same time, as we grovel with that, we come to the reality of our need for God. Our need for a God that is alive, that interacts with us in ways that are unusual. Ways that bring light into our situations. Ways that take our fear and our fragileness at times, and we can be reminded that we are not alone. That we have a church to come to where we can be real. Where we can talk about the desires of our hearts, our disappointments, and our fears. And sometimes we just have to take that risk, church, to get out of our comfortable beds But sometimes when life is so overwhelming, we just want to stay there. But pull up the covers and stay in that place. Probably the most dangerous thing you can do. Because if you're anything like me, when I stay in that place with the covers over my head, as warm and comfortable as it might be, the only thing I do there is think. Think about me. My therapist once said to me, Kenny, it's not that you think too highly of yourself or too lowly of yourself, it's that you always think of yourself. Right. I'm paying this guy. Right? But isn't that the truth? Fear. False evidence appearing real. Disappointment.
I'm not in my way.
Health issues. Our lives can fall apart, right? And as they do, we come to a place where we can be reminded to see what God is doing, to hear what God is saying in the world. And as we dare to become that real with ourselves and with one another, our thoughts, our realities are transformed, because then all of a sudden we're not thinking about ourselves, but we live into the newness of Jesus being born again, realizing that Jesus envelopes us with love and grace that will change our situation. It may not change the health issue, it may not change the brokenness of the relationship, but it will help us to endure. It will help us to know that asking the questions are okay. It will help us to know that we celebrate the birth of the Messiah that allows us to be who we are. And how amazing is that? That instead of beating ourselves up, we could speak our truth. We could speak our fears. We could let our questions out. And in that, have a new reality. Not because of who we are, but because of the God who says, I love you more than life itself. The God who says, in a manger, a trough to feed animals, my son will be born, and a world will be different. A God who says, about pain and brokenness, but it's those people that hurt the most that get my heart, not the powerful government. Did you hear that, church? Not the powerful government. And we're going to change this government that we've been given, right? Yes. Because we're not going to be shy. I'm going to be just like Troy told you. I'm going to spread my skirt in Washington, D.C. and invite y'all to come with me. Get ready. For God who says, twirl your skirt. But know that it's this cross that has given us liberty. It's a gory, ugly mess. But from that gory, ugly mess comes love profound, which allows us to sing joy to the world, the Lord has come. So when does your God need to come to you? What is the aching of your heart? What is the desire? Where is your need? I encourage you to give it to God in a new way, to place those things at the manger or at the cross, whatever makes sense to you, knowing that you don't journey alone, because we have a church with people filled with questions, filled with doubts, and Jesus says that it's okay, but keep your ears and your eyes open. Can we do that?